feel when they wait for that call back. Because I sat there for about a week and I'm like, is he going to call me back? Yeah, like, is this just a one-time thing? Or
that's what we want to do here. We want to take you to the next level. We want you to achieve your goals.
Hey guys, thank you so much for coming and tuning into this week's Fred Talk. Today we have Ryan here. He is the owner of Modern and Traditional Barbering, a newer barbershop in town. So we get to pick his brain and hear his road to opening up his new shop and just hearing his passion for what he does, and hopefully give you guys some tips and tricks along the way in business. So you can go on and take it away, guys, on how you guys first met.
Yeah, Ryan, how did we first meet?
So it was a Saturday.
It was a Saturday.
Mid Saturday.
Yes, mid Saturday.
And we have so many rules. We had, at the time, I think we were pretty new out of COVID. Mm. We had so many rules. We're not allowed to take same day appointments and this and that. And, or we're not allowed to take walk-ins, I should say. So my way of getting through that was, okay, we'll do a same day appointment. Mm-hmm. So if you walk in and you didn't have an appointment, no big deal. We can set you up with a same day appointment.
Oh, okay.
So Freddie walks in and approach him and says, hey, do you have an appointment? Do I need one? And I think that was the last, I think that was it. I think.
I walked out.
Yeah.
I have to preface it with, there was nothing wrong with Ryan, okay? I was just in that mood because I was getting like sick of COVID and sick of the rules. And I'm like, you know, whatever happened to the days when I could walk into a barbershop and you listen to everybody talk shit and you just like took a number or they knew when you were going to go and then you just called them up. So I guess I might have just missed normalcy. So I walk in. He's like, I got an appointment. I'm like, nah. Or I said, do I need one or whatever? And he was like, no, you know, you need one. I was like, all right. And I just walked out. Yeah. Just walked out. Right. That's what happened.
Yeah. So what you missed after you walked off, the music in the shop cut off, went completely silent. Everybody was just like, whoa, what just
did
happened?
Did it?
Got real awkward. No. No. But I stood there for a second. I was like, wait, I don't know. I just didn't. I'm like, I think I know that guy, A. I've seen him on billboards before.
Yeah.
Not sure if I like that exchange. Did I do something wrong?
No.
So I chased him out to the parking lot.
Yeah. He came out to the parking lot, came out to the truck. And Jill was driving my truck because I was going to stay there and she was going to go home. So from my point of view, I'm thinking this guy just came out. He's like, did I do something wrong? And I was like, no, man. And then my wife was just like, he likes to get bent out of shape every once in a while. Right. And I was like, no, man. It was, and then you were just like, you're Freddie, right? And then when he said that, I was like, fuck. Right. Because now I'm thinking to myself. And
I'm not going to lie. I had you there, too. I was like, I know that guy.
Yeah. And I was like, ah. You're friends with Eric. And I'm like, oh, man. So then, you know.
Major guilt trip.
Right. And then he was like, if you ever need anything, just get your haircut, let us know. And so he goes back inside. And I'm just sitting there. And Jill's just like, what the fuck did you do? You know? And it's just, I'm like. So first of all, I'm sitting there going, ah. I didn't think it was a terrible exchange. I'm not saying I was proud of what I did, but it wasn't like I yelled at him.
Right.
Or, you know, it was just, yeah, I just like walked out because out of sheer frustration. And, but here's the thing. Here's a caveat or whatever you want to call it. Here's the cool part. So I'm in the truck. Jill's driving home because I'm already aggravated because of what happened afterwards, how he came out and he knew who I was. And you always have to remember Berks County is really small.
Mm-hmm. Especially in the business world.
Oh, my goodness, is it super small. This guy knew who I was, and I never met him in my life. So there's a tip, kids. Don't be a dick, right? Which I've always said, because you don't know who the hell knows you, man. So we're driving home, and we get to the house, and I get out of the truck, and I was like, give me the keys. And I grabbed the keys. I promptly went to the liquor store, and I got a nice bottle of Patron. I was like, Patron says I'm sorry between guys, right? I think Patron says I'm sorry between two gentlemen. And then I go back to his shop, and I'm like, yo, man, this is not who I am. This is not how I want our first interaction to be. My bad. I'm sorry. Here's the thing of Patron. And I could still see Ryan was a little bit frustrated by the interaction. I could tell, which rightfully so, because he's doing business, and some guy just walks in and walks out. He stops cutting hair to come out to see what happened. So So think about that for a second, right? Mm-hmm. And then he just says, you still want to get your hair cut, man? And I'm like, yeah, by you. He's like, okay, come back at 4 o'clock, right? Now, what I did not know at the time was he closes at 4 o'clock. So instead of closing up shop and going home for the day, this guy still waits to cut this guy's hair. And so think about it. Even through all that, he still was like, can I still cut your hair? I'll do it after closing time on his time, practically. I mean, he owns the place, but still, that's his time. Once it closes, that's his time. And it was one of the greatest haircuts I ever got. I still go to him since. Mm-hmm. I have not been anywhere else. And that just shows true professionalism, that he loves his craft, that he knows people still have bad days, and that's a judge right away. So much so that he's right here next to me on Fred Talk. So if that says anything, it's a testament to his character. Mm-hmm. So Ryan, thank you very much for coming in and hanging out with us, even though I was a dick. And hopefully you enjoyed the Patron. And so yeah, he's a cool guy. You should go to his shop, Modern Traditional, great place to get your hair cut. That's why I look sexy. That's why my wife loves me. And I have to go back because it's already getting a little long, so I got to get in there. But, you know, outside of that crazy story, what about you, bro? Why don't you let us know, you know, what's your story? Like, why did you even become a barber? Why did you want to be a barber? Like, just tell us a little bit about yourself and, you know, let the people know who Ryan is.
So I have tons of pictures of me as a little kid. Bowl cut. Just that was all throughout my whole childhood.
Didn't we all have that?
No.
Staple in the 90s.
Mm-hmm.
My mom was a single mom, so I always tagged along with her to the salon. And then after she remarried, my dad was like, all right, you're going to get a real haircut. So it was like right before baseball and or right when it was getting hot out. I always had long hair. Takes me to the city to a barber he knows that's a friend of his nephew. And I got my first haircut, and I was like just sold. Like I was sold on the whole experience. It's like a tiny, probably 200 square foot barbershop, but I was just kind of amazed by the whole thing. I was like, this guy just like sits here and hangs out all day, and this is his job. Like this is what he does, and you know, he has his own, this is his little kingdom, his little castle, whatever you want to call it. So my dad got sick of taking me to the barbershop all the time. So the 1 year for Christmas, he buys me a set of clippers. And he says, figure out how to cut your own hair. Which kind of sounds aggressive. Like I tell people that and they're like, oh, whoa. But to the people who don't know, my dad is, he was self-taught everything. Tinkerer, knew how to do everything, mechanic by trade. Anything that broke, that had a gear, he just knew how to do it. So I started cutting my own hair. And one day, one of my friends was like, you have clippers, right? I was like, yeah, but I've never cut anybody else's hair before. I started cutting his hair, started cutting the next person's hair, and that's kind of just how it started.
How the hell do you cut the back of your head?
You hold a mirror.
Oh my God. Head,
go back around and follow it.
Oh, all right. That takes skill, I think. Right?
It's like completely, there's barbers who are, you can be the best barber in the world but not know how to cut your own hair and vice versa. Like I've seen barbers who can cut, you know, their own hair crazy, but you know, it is its own, it's a skill in its own.
I would say so. Jeez. Yeah. I can't even cut my own beard. Like I put a 2-clip on. I'm just like, that's about it for now. I'm like, Ryan, can you clean this? And he cleans it because I'm terrible at it.
My roommate, she like loves to cut hair. She wants to go to school for like color theory and all that kind of stuff. But I had my hair is growing back finally from like I had both my sides shaved for about 2 years. And that was just really fun too. I just love going to the barbershop over like a salon, because a lot of salons like nowadays aren't like that traditional where all the girls are talking and gossiping and whatever. It's really just like awkward unless you have someone you know, and
you almost have to know somebody.
Yeah.
Yes.
Where like when I go to like the barbers, I've been to a few different ones around here, and like just have a nice beer, just watch some TV, like make some small talk, and then like it's cool, you know. And so, but she would always tell me like, oh well, if you want I can just like do it myself, and I'm like, no. And this is my roommate. I'm just like
it's an experience.
Yeah,
which is why I think I was so frustrated that day, because I needed the barbershop again. Mm-hmm. Like for a man, a barbershop's a thing. You know, and a lot, I'm not saying all women, but a lot of women don't get it.
It's
sometimes.
Like the nail salon for women.
Right. Okay, maybe that's what it is. Like they go to the nail salon, they're talking to their nail tech and they're doing a thing. Same thing at a barbershop. And you know, and you're not quick to always leave or feel bad about waiting. Like you get to hear what's happening just by people talking. And for the most part, it's always dudes. And y'all, you know how dudes are. We get together, we talk all kinds of shit. But that's part of like your Saturday afternoon. Is going to the barbershop. It's kind of like that movie with Ice Cube. Like, obviously, it's a little heightened because it's a movie. You know, nobody's like stealing ATM machines and shit. But at least I don't think so. But the camaraderie of hanging out and just talking and just, you know, it's very cool. Like, even the last time I was there, I started finding myself even interacting with the other guys that are there, which I haven't done yet.
Mm-hmm.
Like, you hear them say one thing, you don't feel uncomfortable interrupting and go, yeah, you know, it's all about this and it's all about that. And they're like, yeah, you're right. And they nod along. It's like, there we go. Mm. Now you're starting to find your place. And it's really important for a dude to find his barbershop. Like I found, this is my fourth place I think I've been to. And it's great. It's the best one I've been to yet. And I don't see myself ever going anywhere else unless he leaves and then I can see me going somewhere else. But it's just, it's nice to find your home. Mm-hmm. You got to have that home spot, that home base. You know, it's like a beer. It's like your dude finds a beer he likes. That's his fucking beer. Same thing with a barbershop, dude. Yeah. You're marrying the shop. Yeah, I mean, it's that important.
I actually talked about it a little bit this weekend. It's like we have a unique job. Like, we cut hair, but we're also, like, part-time therapists.
Hell yeah. Hell yeah.
Stuff, like, sometimes, like, I was talking about it lightheartedly this weekend, but there has literally been times where people have told me things, and I'm like, yeah, I'm not qualified to give you advice on this.
But you are.
Like, I'm going to finish your haircut.
But you are.
But yeah.
Because you're.
With a grain of salt. But
you're right. Like, but you're like, you're not.
You're unbiased.
Right.
Opinion.
You're the barber, man. Like, yo, I'm going to tell this guy because he won't judge me. He's here to make me look good. Normally I say, well, it's up to you what you want to do. But no, it definitely makes sense. Yeah. I don't know. No, I mean, I'm, you're right. You are a therapist. I mean, I've had barbers in New York. I've seen this. I remember I saw the same guy. His name was Oscar. I saw him for years before I left New York. I could only imagine the conversations. He probably thought about me. He was like, who the fuck is this guy? But yeah, you talk about it for hours. He was a cool cat. He was a good barber.
So once you found out that you like started to cut all of your friends' hair and things like that, what has led, like, how long have you been cutting hair outside of, like, the shop? And then, like, how did the shop idea and just all of that
okay,
come
so
about?
I guess I was really not taking it that seriously when I was cutting in high school. Mm-hmm. But I went and I got advice from somebody, where should I go to school? And at the time, the only barber school in Berks County was Charlie Haynes.
Okay.
And he's, I don't know if you know Charlie Haynes, but he's, like, the godfather of barbering in Reading. His school's on 400 block School Ave,
okay.
Down by the bridge, the IGA.
Okay, yeah.
So that was like when I started getting into it professionally.
Mm-hmm.
I went to barber school and I was going to RAC at the same time because I still wasn't sure if I wanted to go to college.
Mm-hmm.
Like, all my friends went to college. Like, I felt like I was doing something wrong.
Mm-hmm.
I was like, I should be in college right now. And I'm not the college type. So I stuck with barbering, and then it really kind of started treating me well. And my dad was my dad gave me a lot of reassurance because I think he went through that. He was a self-made mechanic, or started as a mechanic to owning his own Harley Davidson dealership.
Mm-hmm.
Wow.
And that's cool. So he kind of always like enforced that on me. He's like, if you just keep plugging, things will start falling into motion, falling into play. So 18, I started taking it seriously. I actually started right up the street at a salon because I felt comfortable. I was like, I'm not good enough at cutting hair. I'm not ready to be in the barbershop. I was afraid.
Mm-hmm.
And this was like pre-Instagram. This is pre-social media. This is all just like, you know, now as a barber, it's kind of nice. You can just go on and you can learn so many things and see all these people and, you know, have all these people rooting for you. But back then, I kind of felt alone. I was like, I'm in a what's being called as a dying trade.
Mm. How old are you, bro? You make it sound like you're
only 27.
That's, I mean, 10 years ago was social media, right?
Uh-huh.
Was it that old? Well, no, not the way it is now, but I'm like, guy's talking like he's 60. I'm like, you know, it's like, so he's 27. Yeah. They were saying it was a dying art back then.
Really? Yeah, it was dying art.
Jesus, the barber shop? Well, I will say that there has been the resurgence of, I guess, the old way of barbering. See, I'm used to going to a barber shop to cut your hair, you're out.
Right.
Now it's different. Now you're like, it is more of an experience.
It's more grooming.
It's grooming,
right?
Correct.
Yeah,
I never gave a shit about hair and beard and stuff. I really didn't, which you should always. But like, I went and got the haircut, washed my hair. Like, that was the extent of my grooming.
Mm-hmm.
And my wife was the one that pushed me to go towards like having the experience and all that stuff. But yeah, I mean, I could see the resurgence. It's funny. I never thought it was a dying art. It's definitely cooler now.
I think it's probably the second longest. Like, what's older than barbering besides prostitution?
Yeah. Well, they call that the oldest profession, right?
Oldest profession.
Right.
But I'll never forget about my so while I was still in school finishing up, I was working at a grocery store, third shift, stock at nights. And my last day working there, the manager, we were outside on a smoke break, and I was talking to the manager, and she was asking me what my plans were, what I'm doing. I'm like, oh, I'm finishing up barber school. I'm going to go do this and go do that. She's like, oh, yeah. She's like, you'll be back. She said, I'll never forget. She's like, yeah, you'll be back. She says, my nephew or so-and-so is in there. There's no money in here. You'll be back.
What?
Oh, my God.
I finished my shift, and then I was like, yeah.
See ya.
Thanks, guys.
Jesus. There's no money in here, apparently.
No, there's
you only own your own business on State Hill Road and you seem like you're doing okay.
There's
with me,
no money in here, yeah.
There's no money in here. There's no money in any of it.
What you guys are talking about, like the old school way, like versus now modern? Like, what's the difference? Like, is there like a cutting difference?
Kind of my interpretation of it, and since I am so young, I wouldn't know if I'm saying.
I'm old, bro.
So my interpretation of it, it was like, seemed like 70s, 80s, 90s. Like, one type of guy got his hair cut at a barbershop, and one type of guy got his hair cut at a salon.
Mm-hmm. I remember
that.
And
it was,
yeah,
like, kind of the more, like, metro, like, it seemed like almost the grooming experiences happened at the salons.
Oh, okay.
So it was, like, kind of divided to where now I feel like the shoe's on the other foot, and now when you want that experience, you go to a barbershop.
Right, where it was almost like back in the day, if you were a man, you went to a barbershop. You did not go to a salon. You know, so I can get the metrosexual thing,
yeah,
right? Where taking care of yourself is like faux pas, right? Is that what I mean? So I think I was stuck in that. I won't lie. Like, I mean, I grew up with an Ecuadorian father, pretty strict, pretty like, you know,
barbershop.
He didn't like any kind of weird haircuts. It's funny. He made me part my hair all the time when I was a kid, and now I do it on purpose, you know? But back then it was like, part your hair this way and this way. Like, you know, so. You know, I guess you had to be a man and go to a barbershop, where now it's that part's different. Yeah, it's a cooler to be, I guess, groomed.
For sure.
But it is cool. I mean, I think it's awesome. But I want to go back to your manager at the supermarket. So, like, okay. I love it when people tell me I can't do shit, right? Because you literally just threw a can of gasoline on a fire.
Mm-hmm.
So how did you react to, you know, okay, she said that, you were like, all right, whatever. But, like, what happened on the inside? Like, or did you even have an event on the inside? Was that, like, the thing? Or, like, you know, because I would have been pissed.
Well, I think first I was like, well, I'm not going to be the manager of this grocery store someday, mm-hmm, so I'm out, one. And two, I think it kind of, like you said, it puts that fire into you. And at that point, I really hadn't made much money. Like, at that point, I hadn't made any money. I was still like a barber student, and I think it made me really want to just hit the ground running.
Right.
Like, that was why I was like, you know what, I'm gonna make this just work, and I don't need to work third shift now. I'm gonna cut hair and make it happen.
And so you wanted to be a barber, you wanted to kick some ass, right on. Mm-hmm. When did you have the I want my own shop little feeling?
I think it was all along, but I didn't know what type. It took me a while to figure out what type of shop I wanted. I always, from the time I got my first haircut in the city, I wanted my own shop.
Mm.
Like, I knew then. I'm like, I need my own shop. But what type of shop do I want?
What does that mean?
Do you want the mom and pop barbershop? Do you want the walk in and take a ticket? you know, do you want a two chair? Do you want the one chair barbershop? A two chair? What are you trying to, you know what I mean? Like mm-hmm. every personality you bring into a shop adds like a whole another dimension. If you have a 10 chair shop versus a 5 chair shop, things like that.
Like the personalities of the barbers.
Right. Oh,
okay.
And kind of like what you're going for. Are you going for, I hate to say like mom and pop barbershop. I keep saying that. I feel like I'm dogging
them. It's not a bad thing. You know, we like mom and pops.
Versus like,
mom
like pop a modern like
you know,
feel.
Or are you going for the home run? Are you trying to have a 10 chair, you know, upper mm-hmm. echelon barbershop? You know, are you trying to be high end, middle of the road?
So 10 chairs high end? I don't know anything about this, though. That's why
I'm not asking. So is that why you call it modern and traditional?
Yeah.
Yeah, where'd you get the name?
I was stuck on the name for a while. And it was kind of a weird name because it's more of what we do than mm-hmm. who we are. But I think when you walk in, it kind of all makes sense. Like you can see how there are
a it's blend modern. Of the two. When you walk in, it's definitely not an old school looking place. It's definitely modern, very clean. But the work coming out of there is not, I don't want to say it's not modern, but it's traditional. Like you walk in there going like, what the fuck did I just walk into? But when you get the cut, you're like, oh shit, all right. These guys are legit. Like if you, modern and traditional. It makes total sense. I mean, he didn't really beat around the bush with the name, I think. He was just like, yo, this is what I do. So either you do or you don't, mm-hmm. obviously. So I did, thank goodness. Yeah, great, great. It just, you know. So first of all, before we continue, everybody out there in IG Live, thank you for checking. And if you have questions, please feel free and drop them in the comments area. We got Angie over here making sure everything's rocking and rolling. If you have any questions for Ryan, now's your chance and all those great things. So please get involved and definitely check them out on State Hill Road if you need your next cut. But when did you finally realize I'm jumping in the pool? I'm going to, you know, sink or swim. Like this is it. This is when it's happening.
So like, I think the best way to tell it would be when I actually like pulled the trigger and mm-hmm. went and did everything. So one of my clients who get this, I got him as a client because I stayed late for him. I've been cutting his hair for like 10 years.
It works.
There's something to that.
There's something
for somebody one time and
customer service speaks volumes.
So he ends up turning out to be one of my closest friends and one of my biggest mentors. And we're talking, and every time I would be looking for locations, he'd be the first person I'd send it to. What do you think of this? What do you think of this? And we were talking about the shop, the location on State Hill Road, and he kind of just he called me out. He's like, "You're tiptoeing around it." He's like, "You just don't want to do it." And like, just he's like. He's like, "You've been looking at spots for over a year now. Everything's mm-hmm. got something wrong with it." He's like, "This is the perfect spot." He's like, "That's the spot. You don't want to do it." He's like, "You've accomplished everything you said you wanted to. Haircutting, you're ready. Everything's ready. It's there." He's like, "But you don't want to do it." And then I went and did it.
So he literally pushed you into the pool. A kinda.
No, I think he pulled me away from the pool. And I was like, "No, I'm going in the pool."
Okay. I think, but that's one way of pushing people in is by saying, "Oh, you don't want to do it." Mm-hmm. He probably said more than that.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
I could almost imagine the conversation in my head because I've had that conversation with people.
I got off the phone with him. I was just like, "Dang."
Sometimes you need that.
Me. Yeah.
Yeah. It's like, dude, it's now or never. Like, stop screwing around. And so, how long have you had that location now?
So I started my build out in November of 2019.
Oh, perfect timing.
Little did I know.
Yeah.
So, started the build out. Had plans to be open by February.
Mm-hmm.
It was a great plan.
Awesome plan.
It was a good plan. But yeah, nah.
COVID.
Mm. So, June 26th is when we actually opened.
June 26th.
Wow. June 26th.
When did I go see you for your haircut?
Probably tell you if I looked it up.
I mean, we ain't got to do all that, but August?
Yeah.
Jeez.
It's pretty close into it.
Wow. So you were only there. I didn't even think you were only there 2 months. I thought you were there for a minute already.
No.
And we've had this conversation. I know we have, but like, June. I don't think I ever heard June 26th, though. So that's That's interesting. Wow.
I went there last week and it was great.
That's right. My experience was great. Who'd you have?
I had Jay. He was
there.
Fine.
You go. There you go. Nice guy. See, even my kid goes there. Nice. There you go. I have a good question, man. Like, but what made you like you said you were hooked, you know, you saw the barbershop thing, but like, I don't know, like, here's a good question. What makes you love cutting hair? Like, what about it makes you dig it? Like, yeah, you were at a barbershop, you had experience with your dad, you're like, yeah, I love doing this, but like, what about it drives you to want to literally dedicate your life to the craft?
I think it's the social aspect of it. And I didn't really learn that until quarantine. So I was like by myself. Mm. I was like, oh, I didn't see 20 people today and I didn't hear all these different stories. I didn't hear this. I didn't, you know. It when you're in your zone and your own element, everything's just, it flows.
Mm-hmm.
And I taught at the American Barber Academy for a while.
Oh, right on.
And I actually took, in barbering, it's kind of a process to get your teacher's license to be an instructor. And I spent, it took a decent amount of time to get it. I was for sure that's like what I wanted to do. I wanted to be an instructor. And it wasn't the same. Like punching a clock, and it was just, it really wasn't
the same.
Didn't
have like the freedom.
Yeah. I didn't feel that same type of,
mm-hmm.
you know, vibe that the barbershop gives. And plus, I mean, I would answer your question with a question. If you walk into the barbershop, that's the vibe you feel.
Mm-hmm.
It's not a bad place to work.
No, which is why I love it in here. I made sure when I bought this place, I set it up so that people wouldn't want to leave.
Right.
Like they would feel comfortable just hanging out in here. You know, I just want them to chill. I want them to hang out. I don't want them to feel like they have to leave. I've never received a bad comment on the office, which is pretty cool. But yeah, it all comes into play. I mean, it's the vibe especially. I don't mind going to work. Like ever, mm-hmm. you know, I look forward to coming in. Like I'll get up early. Today I got up early, got up like 4 o'clock. Not because I wanted to. My body just woke up and I was like, okay, well, I'm going to the office. And I wasn't even like mad about it. I came in, walked in, had a cup of coffee. It was just good to go. So I understand, you know, but I'm just always so interested in like, you know, what drives people to do things that they do, you know, mm-hmm. and the love, because that's part of the reason why we even do these talks is to let, you know, people know, like, you know, it's cool to be an entrepreneur, yeah. But, like, at the end of the day, though you might have heard it a million times, it's all about love, man. And, like, it doesn't matter. Like, I find it's, like, so much love in building a website. You find so much love in making people look good. You know, Whitley finds so much love in taking photos. You know, Angie finds it in just recording people moving. You know, so the main thing that we always want to address here is, you know, you need to do something you love, no matter what it is, because mm-hmm. happiness is the most important thing you can have in life. Money is great and helps you get through things and you can support your family, but without the love and without happiness, dude, it's just, it's terrible.
It's draining.
Mm-hmm.
I think I had a couple big moments in barbering that I wouldn't say like one of them collectively made it, but those handful moments or so were kind of like, I'm doing this for the rest of my life. I think the first one was the first barbershop I worked at was All Stars. It was out on Rockland, out in the city, Barbering mm-hmm. College. And I was subpar. Like, I was like the barber in the back. And I was like the white guy in the shop that people didn't want to go to.
Sure.
Rightfully so.
Just like barbershop.
Absolutely. So I started there and the guy working next to me for like a solid 2 months, I'd finish a haircut and he'd be like show me all these, how to, he would essentially, not, I don't want to say fix my haircut, but would put the finishing touches on it and show me how to really do everything. So I stayed with All Stars. I was like the little brother at All Stars. And I stayed there for, I was maybe 3-4 years into it. And which year was the first year, but Eric Rodriguez started the Berks County Barber Battle, which if you're not familiar with that, they have a couple different categories, this hairstyle, this hairstyle, this hairstyle. You go on stage, 10 other barbers, and then after after the haircuts, they walk all the models into a room. They have 3-4 judges, and they grade them on various things and first, second, third.
Right on.
So, yeah, the first year that he did it, I was like, I'm just gonna do it. I don't know why. I'm just gonna do it. Like, I don't want to say anything bad about the people I work with because all those guys showed me so much love, but you can sense when somebody doubts you. Mm-hmm. You can sense when it's like, you know, even I doubted myself. I'm like, oh, yeah. But I got third place.
Nice.
My first year.
Hell yeah.
Congratulations.
So that was kind of like a moment where I'm like, no, I can, like, I can be the man. Like, I can, mm-hmm. you know, I can actually do this.
Mm-hmm.
I competed again the next year, placed again. That was kind of big early on in confidence, but my next one, I would say the one that if I had to put above everything was cutting out Sean Jeffrey's hair.
Mm-hmm.
Like, that was kind of like, that was one of just, it was just weird. It was, but after I did that, I was like, oh my God, like, this is it. I'm done. This is what I'm going to, I'm
Ryan.
Never again.
For our live viewers, or especially Whitley.
I have no idea what's going on.
Or my daughter. Please explain who that gentleman is.
Alshon Jeffrey is a Super Bowl champion for the Eagles. He played wide receiver.
Wow.
He's been hurt last year. He tore his Achilles last year, but should be coming back any week. But I was sitting at home messing around on Instagram. It was like right before training camp started.
Mm-hmm.
I'm following like all these Eagles rookies. I follow like all the players. Yeah, I get a direct message from Alshon Jeffrey. I'm like, no way. and it says, I think it said two words. I think it said, haircut boss. I'm like, is he calling me? I don't
boss.
Know. My haircut boss, like, he's asking for a haircut.
Yeah, he's like,
right.
Yeah. I thought he was just doing fan engagement. A lot of those guys do, they just engage with different people. And he actually sent one of my clients a jersey when he first got to the Eagles. When he first came to the Eagles, one of my clients was on Twitter and, oh, I'm so happy Alshon's here. And he replied to him. He's like, send me your address. I'll send you a signed jersey.
Holy shit.
Send him a signed jersey. So I'm thinking, I'm like, oh, he's probably just, you know, being a nice guy. And he's like, all right, how about 4:30 today at Rittenhouse? And I was like, all right, I'll see you there. And I almost didn't believe it. Like, it was like too good to be true. I was super skeptical. So I walked in there, and it's just him and the homies in the kitchen, and I'm sweating.
I bet you are. I'd have been shitting bricks
the whole ride down. I'm just like, you know, scared. And I never really knew this, but he's from South Carolina. All
right.
And all those guys were down there. So I'm like, I'm struggling to understand what was going on in the room.
Mm-hmm.
I felt like I wasn't speaking the same language.
Mm-hmm.
They have like a really good way of just like saying multiple sentences in like a few words.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean?
Yeah, the South.
Yeah.
Yeah, hell yeah.
So yeah, I cut his hair in his kitchen. I left. I took pictures with him. And that whole ride home, I was just like,
happened?
I was just mind blown.
That's amazing.
So cool.
Like, I don't know. I mean, it was just a really cool experience. And then now I know how women feel when they wait for that call back. Because I sat there for about a week and I'm like, is he going to call me back? Yeah, like, is this just a one-time thing? Or
am
I could
I
be there
a barber
next
now?
Week. Yeah.
Is he calling other barbers? what was that conversation like, dude? Like, okay, so you show up, you see it's him, you're like, okay, I'm gonna cut this dude's hair. But like, did you even go like, why me? Or like, did you ask him any questions?
Everybody
like
asked
that?
Me that. Everybody's like, everybody says, how do you find you? I said, I don't know. Like, I have no idea.
So you never asked him?
No, I always pretended like I was supposed to be there. I never said why.
Good for
me.
You.
Yeah,
hell
yeah.
Like,
yeah,
absolutely, I'm here. It's about time.
Yeah.
You should have called
amazing.
Me last week.
Missing out.
Right? You should have been had call me.
Busting the fucking doors
yeah,
to get on the place.
Yeah.
That's a good tip. That's a good one.
Yeah.
You act like you're supposed to be there.
Mm-hmm.
Right. Like they're fucking lucky you showed up.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. That's like something I need to take myself.
Same. I'm taking that with
because
me today.
Because like when I go out to photo shoots still, like he just harps on me all the time about my prices, that I need to stop being a puss.
She's so good, bro. She's so good. I tell her to stop being a puss. But so it's said with love.
Yes.
But she's really good at her craft. And she just started out, and you know, she's automatically like, well, I'm gonna charge $5 for a photo. And I'm just like, bro, like, you're not a $5 photographer. So that's why I push. And my wife sometimes she'll get on me. She's like, why do you always push people? Just let them do what they want to do.
But it's good, like, because if you didn't do it, and like also like I told you, like Kevin does it for me, like no one else in my life does that. My parents weren't like yours, which I actually wrote down about having like the difference of a parental support. I don't have that. My dad's very chilled out. They had a business and then they sold it when they moved here, but they're not business people. So like, and now they have a decal company, but still it's just not like what they do. And so for me, it's like really just me, my sister starting to get on the entrepreneurial thing, and my roommate kind of here and there, and it's like my boyfriend's kind of here and there, but I have no one really just like calling me out for my shit, you know, or like for slacking or for not raising my prices or and keeping it at a certain standard. And so it's like for that, it's kind of like the confidence aspect. Like I had my first wedding on New Year's Eve and I'm just scared shitless, right? Because I'm gonna be by myself on a first wedding when normally you have someone with you at least, and it's at night, and I've never, like, so I have all these doubts. And he's like, the other day I go in there, I'm like, oh, he's like, Billy, you need to stop talking. You're just like psyching yourself out. You're freaking out right now. So it's just that idea of like, I need to, whenever I feel like going to a shoot, I need to have that sense of like, I am, they're lucky I'm here aspect, you know? And I think that's like such a confidence builder when you say that to yourself over and over. Like, I am supposed to be here. I'm meant to be here. That kind of, I really like that. That was good.
That's actually perfect. You know, which I was going to bring up, you know, but I'm glad you did. And I love that. Fucking A. You know, you act like you're supposed to be there. Right. Which is fucking brilliant. I love it.
So if you ever want a photo shoot.
Yeah.
I'll come over to the shop.
Yeah, she'll do it.
That'd be really fun. So while we like start to wrap up, is there something that you wish you would have known before starting out, if you would have tried a different approach? And then also real quick, kind of like, where do you see you going in the next couple of years?
So like, I saw that question. I'm like, oh, obviously that's such an easy question. I wish I would have known the pandemic was coming. While
you and me both.
We all did, bro.
But advice I got before that even happened from another friend of mine who owns they own a brewery, Shaler. I went to high school with them.
They're
real,
awesome.
Real great people. But he says to me that being an entrepreneur, being in business, it's all about solving problems. And
mm-hmm.
It's you're not done until you can't solve a problem, you know. So it's almost like selfish to be an entrepreneur and be like, I want to see the future, because that's just that's not what it's about. Not to sound cliche, but it's like, I guess that's part of the journey, you know.
Mm-hmm. You have to be. Yeah. You know, it's yeah, you're right. You have to be selfish at times. I think number one, you have to be selfish because you have to enjoy all the hard work. Number one, that we're built to do this. We're built to take risks. We're built to prepare ourselves to fail, but to learn from failures. But there comes a time where, you know what? Sometimes you have to be selfish and you have to just sit back and be like, I ain't doing shit today because I don't have to, because I own my own shit. I mean, that's pretty much it. So I think I'm into that. I can definitely get behind that all day, you know?
And like, what is a piece of advice that you would give someone, or like maybe your previous self, for like entrepreneurs out there or anyone looking to do something?
I got there's this like intuition that I got, and I feel like it's very new since I've like bought my house.
Because
like, you see a bunch of houses, and they always say that like, once you find yours, like you just know right away. And I feel like that's the same way with business and everything. Like, it took me a while till you just, it's there.
Mm-hmm.
It's, I feel like it's got to be intuitive, you know?
Mm.
Sometimes you catch lightning in a bottle, but, you know?
I think that's, like, really what we were talking about on one of these, about, like, eventually finding your true passion, you know? Like, there's so many different things I tried and I thought I liked or whatever, but it is, like, having that, like, once you find it, it's, like, bam, like, this is what I do. And I love it. And like you said, like, you don't feel like it's work, you know? And I think that's something that some people will try to figure out. But one of the things my dad really taught me was not asking everyone and their mom for their opinion. Because when you start to do that, they, again, like I said last time, it's like they put their fears onto you, and that creates more self-doubt. But not only that, but they can start to try to, like, oh, well, you're really good at art, so you should just do art. But I really love paint, like, photography, so I want to do that. Well, this is what you already know, so you should keep doing that. So they'll just, like, kind of divide, even though you're really good at a few things, because you keep asking everybody else besides just, like, listening to yourself. Because that's something I've had to learn so many times. It's like, you know what? I feel like this is my decision, and this is where I'm going. I don't need to ask the world what they think right now.
Listening to your gut is something that people need to start doing, you know. And even if you listen to your gut and you fail, but at least you did it on your own.
Mm-hmm.
Like, instead of somebody else told you to do some shit and then you fail, because then that's gonna kill you. Where you're like, I shouldn't listen to that motherfucker. You know, that's all you're gonna say. And I've been there a million times.
Mm-hmm.
I've let other people affect my decision. And I always tell my kids, man, you know, living with what ifs is the worst thing in life.
Oh my gosh, yeah.
You know, and there's been times where I've let other people's comments, not even them telling me, just them commenting a certain way, has made me change certain things in my life.
Mm-hmm.
And I still go back and I'm like, stupid ass.
Yeah.
You should did it.
And this probably happened with you too. Like, as you're starting to, like, cut other friends' hair and they're liking it, you know, and it's kind of making you feel a little bit more secure in your skill. Something I've noticed too with me is, like, it doesn't matter how, like, I have not had one person tell me my photography is bad, but I'm still fighting. Like, it's like this, like, I take it with a grain of salt rather than taking my negative thoughts as a grain of salt. You know, I'm like, this is what people are actually saying versus what I think in my head. And, like, did you experience that where, like, even though people are telling you you're doing such a good job, whatever, you still have this, like, battle?
Absolutely.
You know?
And it's tough, like, some days behind the chair. Like, people think we're robots. Like, we're perfect, always perfect. And you could give somebody 500 good haircuts, but they'll never forget that one time, you know.
Yeah, that's so true.
I'm just glad he forgot. I don't know if he forgot yet.
Yeah.
You know, but that's so true. Like, you're only as good as, like, the worst thing you did, right?
Mm-hmm.
Ugh, God. And you try to fix that a million times and just... That's why I even bust on Whitley sometimes. I'm like, Whitley, we have to be this anal and this detail-y about something. Sometimes she's like, Jesus Christ, right? And I know she is. But I'm like, we're not allowed to make mistakes, especially as a marketing company. We're not allowed to make mistakes. If I make a mistake, it's like, well, if he can't even take care of his own stuff, how the hell is he going to take care of me?
Yeah. You know? And I do. It gets annoying. But it's also good. Like I said, like, I don't have anyone else telling me this stuff in my life. And, like, and even in my professional life now, I tell him, like, I'll be looking at something and I'm like, oh, I feel like anal because I'm like, that's not how it's supposed to look. Or this could be different, or this could be different. And so I'm even being able to use it in my own life now. But yeah, it's sometimes I'm just like, oh, come on. No one's going to notice. No one's going to know. Like, you know,
no.
But then, like you said, like, everyone's watching at all times. Like, once you put yourself in that spotlight on purpose, people are going to watch and wait for you to trip up or whatever, and they will call you out whether they love you or they're just trying to hate. So
every time I've ever stepped on stage, like, at a competition, and it is funny because I didn't really notice it until, like, I won a couple times, but like, other peers, people I would see, they'd come up to me like, how'd you do? And I'm like, and then I would place.
Yeah, dude.
So it's like a weird thing because it like, your perception and your reality are, like, two very different things. Because, like, I just got done a haircut on stage and I'm out front smoking cigarettes being like, oh man, I just that wasn't it. And then 2 hours later you play, you know, so mm-hmm. it's a weird thing.
Yeah, I don't think it ever goes away.
Yeah,
I still second guess myself now, you know, building websites. I'm like, Fred, you've been doing this for over 20 years. And I'll do something and go, man, that sucked. And I don't even like it. But like I'm on a deadline, so I'm like, well, I got to send them something. I can always fix it afterwards. I still want to show them that I did do something so they see it.
Mm-hmm.
He'll get an email. This is beautiful. Fantastic. I was like, what? All right. You dig it? I dig it. You know, and we're good to go. But we definitely, you're always going to be your own worst critic.
Mm-hmm.
No matter how perfect it is, you're just like, that sucked.
I know.
And the people are just like, you're out of your mind.
You only get one lens to look at it through.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And that's, I mean, and that's part of the reason why it eventually inspires you or pushes you to hire other people to work for you too, because then you start to realize that not everybody sees the world through your lens. You're like, you need to look at other people's perspectives.
Mm-hmm.
And like Whitley's opened my eyes to certain things, and Macy that works for me, and Ange, you know, and even like the other people we use as like contractors, they start to like make you think differently, you know? So yeah, man, that's a good one too. You know, you only see the world through your lens.
Mm-hmm.
So that's like a good thing and a bad thing.
Yeah.
You know, all together. So
thanks so much for coming today.
Yeah, man. So cool.
See?
I feel
so
very honored. I feel very, very honored.
I didn't sweat much, I don't think. So.
No, Eric beat me. Eric's the number one sweater. Eric's the number one sweater.
Sorry, Eric.
I felt bad for that dude. Because I was like, it's just me, bro. You see me all the time. I'm literally at your place all the time. What are you worried about?
Yeah.
You know, so yeah, thanks, dude. I mean, I really appreciate it. You know, everything. Yeah,
good conversation and lots of takeaways.
A lot of good takeaways, man. Definitely. And I only wish you success, man. And, you know, I'll be making an appointment at some point today. You know what we should do? We should do like a live haircut podcast.
Yeah, that'd be fun.
That would have been great.
Well, we can do it.
We can do it again.
And still.
We'll bring them back on next year.
365 days this year.
Yeah, we'll do it.
I was thinking, like, what if they filmed the barber competition and like made it like a Berks County show?
Yeah,
that would be kind of cool.
Because I've heard of the competition before. This should
I've
make
never
a
heard
bigger
of it.
Deal about it. You never? Oh, I've heard of it from like other barbers I went to. They're like, oh, we should go to this barber competition.
It's a little like of a niche type thing, but I mean, he gets great numbers, over 1,000 people.
It sounds interesting.
For here, it's a lot of people.
I mean, can you go as a random person?
Yeah. Oh, absolutely.
I would love to be a spectator.
So you should be
as my time as a barber. I've had a few, maybe like 3-5 of my clients say, hey, how do I become a barber? And I've got them into like the barber academy. But the 1 year I took the model that I took to the show, he hung out for the whole day. He's actually in the barber academy right now.
Huh. Oh, nice.
That's
so it is,
cool.
It is,
man.
A really cool experience there. You kind of get a glimpse of the culture. I think that's kind of what sold him on it, was just kind of seeing what it's all about.
Yeah.
It's cool to get insight into everybody's like culture.
Yeah.
Like, you know, talking to Eric about restaurants and food, and talking to you about barbershops, and it's cool to get a little peek into like what happens behind the scenes. And I know that's a lot of people say that, but you know, barbershops are a big deal. Sneakerheads are another big deal. That's a whole other, I would love to get a sneakerhead in here, you know, talk about like that whole thing, you know. I mean, because I grew up,
I got one for you,
there you go. All right, well, there we go. But you growing up in Jackson Heights, like, even though I was a metalhead growing up in Jackson Heights, I mean, Jackson Heights was a hip-hop neighborhood. Like, you know, I mean, I was a stone's throw from, like, Nas's area. You know what I mean? Like, all those dudes, Kid and Play, back in the 90s, they were up the block from us. It's nice to get a glimpse into what, you know, that is a little bit, you know, just to see what goes on. Because there's more out there than just, you know, whatever you're into. So it's cool to do these things and to talk to people and just see what's up in their world.
Yeah.
Which is what we dig.
So before we do the plug, I have a couple questions from Justin. He's been blowing up the comments for us.
Thanks, Justin.
So he said, do you have any other services? Do you do like eyebrows, backs, stuff like that?
Backs?
Yeah, I don't know. He put back, so
he's
just wanted
a werewolf.
To put it in there.
Waxing?
No backs right now, but yeah.
You better get on that. That's a niche right there.
Apparently.
But no, our haircuts are full service. They include razor, eyebrows, everything works.
Awesome.
Just make it simple rather than like that a la carte kind of system where you feel like, you know, I came in for a haircut, but now I got
pick and choose. Yeah.
Put everything on one.
I like it.
Now you said, how much should we tip?
How much do we tip or how much is a good tip?
Yeah, how much should we tip?
How much should we tip? It's funny, they were just talking about this on Instagram the other day. I feel like typically it's like you round up to the closest 10 as like a standard of a tip. So like $5 would be like is like the standard tip. And then once you get into the 20s range, it's like your high tippers, I would say. So
nice. So $20.
I think I did like 25% last time. So
dun, dun, dun. That's cool. There you go.
Not $20, but my haircut was $20, and that literally that rocked my world because I've been going to the salon because I'm a girl. So like I usually go to the salon, and then he was like, Jay literally rang me up. He was like, all right, $20. I was like, what? I know. Actually.
Yeah, so we get $5 off for the first time.
Oh, really?
There, yeah.
Nice.
He charged me $5 extra.
And a bottle of Patron.
Yeah. He's like, dick charge.
So funny. So go ahead and plug all your information, then we'll wrap it up, and we'll be good to go.
All right. So the shop is at 2111 State Hill Road. We are Starbucks, FedEx. We're right next to SolidWorks. Mm-hmm. So we got pretty easy landmarks. You can book online at moderntraditionalbarbering.com.
Nice.
How easy is it?
It's super easy. I did
He went from a walking guy to an appointment guy.
Hey, you know what? Well, you know what? My favorite part is you can pay for it right away.
Oh, really?
So I go on there. I book it. I pay for it. And I walk in. He says, what's up? Little pound, little cut. I'm out. Like, that's it. There's no more waiting.
That's nice that you can pay
for me is nice because I'll do it during the work day. So I'm like, I'm back in. That was quick. I was back quick last time I went, like last week or whatever it was. I really like that feature. I like paying ahead of time.
So now I want you to go into a mom and pop shop and tell them, hey, you guys got to.
Yo, you guys got to get like scheduling happening. I'll never walk into another shop at this point. I think I might get shot.
Well, thank you guys so much for tuning in. We will announce next week's guest or topic later this week. And as always, let's go out and create something awesome today.
And buy gift cards for modern and traditional, because you can buy gift cards, right?
For the holidays.
Buy gift cards for the holidays.
Awesome. Thank you so much,
thank
guys.
Thank you.
And that's it, bro. Thank you, man. Thanks.